Howard, your family history, you know, things that most likely you have had knowledge about, from, you know, your parents, what their backgrounds were, a little bit about your family, where you grew up, you know, school experience, work experience. I'll kind of guide you through it, but
okay.
you've done this once before with a little bit of a goofy, but a big sister.
So, tell me about your parents and where they came from and a little bit about them.
Well, my dad was born in Grafton, West Virginia.
His name was?
Ophas, O-P-H-A-S, C. Howard, and his mother was Mary Hoskinson, and she married James Carson Howard, which was my dad's dad, of course, and he was a blacksmith, granddad of Howard, and he died at a very early age. The category of 45, but appendicitis at that day and age when they ruptured, why peritonitis set in quick, and he died from that. My dad grew up in the West Virginia area and went to college at the California State Teachers College, and there he met my mother, and after they graduated from college, my dad went to work for American Steel and Wire Company, which was in Denora, and my mother, her parents, were the Reynoldses, John Reynolds. We always called her Nanny Reynolds, and she was Osborne, A-U-S-B-U-R-N, Nell Osborne. And they got married in the Denora area, and...
Now, was your mother a... what did she do for a...
Well, she went to college at the same California, and she was a teacher in the school system. And she taught the primary grades, then in an early teaching career, and then was the equivalent after that of the junior high school class, teaching home economics and things of that nature.
And your father, when he got out of school, what did he do?
American Steel and Wire Company, and in that day and age, why employment was kind of difficult, and he worked in the railroad section of it, where he would check the weights of the rail cars, and he worked there, I believe, as I understand it, for several years, and then my grandfather, Reynolds, had been a carpenter, and he'd been a carpenter. Hi there, Brent, how are you? He'd been a carpenter all of his life, and doing very well in building things in the Denora, Monongahela Valley area. And so, Granddad Reynolds, and my dad, and Granddad Reynolds' son, Charles Reynolds, which is my mother's brother, and an uncle, Todd Osborne, all went together to form Central Lumber Company, which was located in Denora. And it was a pretty howling success. The only thing is, in the fourth or fifth year, They expanded their operation tremendously. And then in about the ninth year, the Depression hit in. And of course, nobody could pay their bills to them. And as a result, they came close to, and matter of fact, did lose the Denora Lumber Company. But Dad then went to work in the steel mills that he was very, very fortunate in getting a job. And he then worked in the storeroom department. And my mother continued to teach. She set up her own kindergarten classes for the junior kids in their home while she would teach for them.
Did you pay for that?
Yeah, but people would pay for it, but not very much in that day and age. And she had about 8 students. And she was very good about it. But
how many kids were in your dad's family?
In my dad's family was Uncle Lynn, which was the oldest, then John Howard, and then Aunt Stell, and then my dad, and then there was a younger brother, Harry, who died around age 2. And then my mother's side was just my mother, Mary Frances, and her brother, Charles.
From that, so it's 5 on the one side, 2 on the other side, and your dad had lost the lumber company, got into the steel company. Where did the cement city concept come in?
Well, the cement, well, first of all, Granddad Reynolds had built his home in Denora, and it was a magnificent. And he, being a contractor, could build very nice places. So he had this magnificent home on McCain Avenue. But when the Depression time came, then my mother and dad moved in with them, and all of the 3 kids in our family, my sister Ruth, which is 5 years older than I am, and myself, and my younger sister, Nancy, who was 5 years younger. So we all ultimately moved in with Grandma and Granddad Reynolds. And they were called Nanny and Pop. And we had a very sociable life with them. And during the time that my dad was working for the steel mills then, during the Depression, but even the mills then practically closed down. And as a result, even though my dad was stores department, and there was no activities, like for all practical purposes, he was laid off at that time. And he was extremely fortunate to be able to get a job with what at that time was the Relief Association. And that simply was that he was a relief investigator, and go around and see the different places that people were living in and who needed food and help distribute food. And as a kid, I was small. The Depression, I was born in 26, but when I was about 5, I used to travel around with my dad, and it created quite an impression in my mind. People lived out by the garbage dump, and they lived in crates, the equivalent of a refrigerator crate down there. It was a very difficult time in the steel mills and during the Great Depression.
Schooling, what about, did they have public schools then?
They had public schools, yes. And Ruthie and Nancy and I all went to public school, Denora High School. We all graduated. Then Ruthie went on to the University of West Virginia, and during my last 2 years of high school, junior and senior year, World War II was in progress. And at that time, because of the war effort, the mills, which had been extremely depressed from the recession, the depression, I should say, started back up again. And it was really a requirement for all of the high school boys to go to work in the mills. So, they had a special arrangement. We would go to school from 8 o'clock in the morning to 2 o'clock in the afternoon, straight through, no lunch break. And then they would excuse you at 2, and you'd have 1 hour to go from the school to your home, get your lunch bucket, and report into the mills at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And during my junior and senior year in high school, we would work till 11 o'clock at night, 3 to 11 shift. And during that time, I did everything from the labor gang, which is just any job at all, shoveling, unloading ores, various types of ores from rail cars. I finally got the job in the, I was over in the open hearth, and I worked on what they called the pull-ups, the open hearth furnaces. They have these big doors on them, and these charging machines with the ladles of scrap steel or various chemicals or raw ore would come up to the furnace in the open hearth, and you'd have to open these doors. It would charge the material into the furnace, and it would simply be a glowing, burning event. And they would dump the cargo out into the furnaces, and you'd then close the door for waiting for the next charge. And then they would ultimately bring the furnaces up to a big temperature, high temperature, and then tap it out into a ladle. And that was a tremendous event to see, was the tapping of the furnaces, where they would knock this plug out in the back, and all this molten steel would pour out into this huge ladle. And then the molten steel would be poured out of the ladle into a bunch of molds, which then caused ingots to be formed inside the molds. Mm-hmm. Getting kind of technical here about steel mills.
You were paid?
Oh, well, we were paid probably, I'm guessing. It's hard to remember, but I probably was making 75 cents to a dollar an hour, which was extremely good pay at that moment in time. And everybody in the town was working.
What about the girls?
Well, Ruthie, who was older than I was, had gotten a job in Pittsburgh, and I believe it was with, I'm not sure, I think it was Westinghouse. She worked in the department stores earlier, but she finally ended up doing engineering drafting work for one of the larger engineering firms in Pittsburgh. I think it was Westinghouse, I'm not sure. Nancy, who was 5 years younger than I, of course, was just coming up in the high school system. So she really didn't graduate until I had graduated from high school and had left and gone off to Kings Point.
There was a 5-year difference, really, between you, both the children.
I was the swing, right in the middle.
That's right. What was your relationship with them? Were they old enough for and young enough for you that you really kind of had your own little single life?
Well, everybody had sort of their own independent life. However, Ruth was old enough and I was young enough that I used to make her life miserable when the boyfriends came around. And Nancy was much too young at that time to even know what was going on. She just went along for the fun of it, whatever it was. But I had a very good relationship with my sisters, and it was a lot of fun. And it was, the Depression years were, in fact, tough. Very, very tough years. When the war years came, things got better. And from that point forward, my mom and dad were able to buy a house in Cement City. And Cement City was an area of Denora that the steel mill was, which was the whole center of business in the community, American Steel and Wire. They decided to branch out from steel, and they made the ingots and the wire and the nails and flat plate and just all sorts of things. But they decided that the wave of the future was going to be for homes made of concrete. But the concrete was reinforced, of course, with steel rod, reinforcing rod, and steel plates where you poured concrete on top of steel plates. So what they did is they built a city called Cement City right in Denora, and they had probably in the category of 200 or 250 homes that were all made out of concrete. The walls were like 12 inches thick, and the floors were very, very thick. And they had electrical wiring, of course, but it was all relatively primitive at that stage when they were built. And to use the homes, though, the homes were assigned to the supervisors in the mill. So, therefore, if you were superintendent of a zinc works, you would get a much better home. And then if you were a general foreman, opening open hearth, you would get a next classification home. But my dad wasn't able to get a home there, even though he was salaried, and at that time was working in the personnel department in the mill. And he ultimately became personnel manager for the steelworks. But finally, Galbreath, out of Pittsburgh, a big real estate individual, decided that he would talk to the mills and arrange with them that they should spin off the homes. So he, in turn, to the best of my knowledge, purchased all of the homes from the steel mills. But it was conditioned upon the that he would resell them by first offering them to the people who lived in them, which were all steel company employees, and then if those people didn't want them, then to offer them to anyone working in the steel mill, and then if they didn't want them, well, then they would be passed down to people, or sold, rather, to people who didn't work for the company. Surprisingly, it was the best deal in town that they were offering, but the attitude of the employees of the steel company was somewhat harsh and objectionable to this whole thing, or they want us to buy the house. And as a result, a lot of them turned down the opportunity to purchase their homes under very favorable terms. So as they turned them down, then my mom and dad were able to go up and put an offer in on the place, and they were able to buy a duplex home. There were three-bedroom homes, or kitchen, dining room, living room, small, but there were two of those homes joined together in the middle. And they bought that, and I think each home was in the category of $2,300. So they had in the category of $5,000 tied up in the whole place, but it was financed. And they redid the homes, constructed new rooms, new divisions, cut through some of the walls, put more electrical things into the place.
When did they buy it?
Well, let's see, it would have been, well, what made it possible was that I had gotten a job in the steel mills in my junior year, and in that same junior year, I'd been working, and Ruthie was working, and I had also been working in a service station prior to going into Ruthie. pushed into the mills. And believe it or not, I was had been able to save up $50 or $75, and my sister Ruthie had somebody about the same. And between the two of us, that $150 combined with probably $100 or so my mom and dad had was enough to make the deposit on the home. And that's what they bought it with. And then
the Galbraiths, were those the same people that owned the Pirates and the
Yes, yes. And they were huge in real estate things, and I believe they were all associated in the Columbus, Ohio area for quite a number of business ventures there. But it was a great thing, and out of that home, I spent my junior, senior year, and I worked in the mills, and it was kind of a interesting way to wind up your high school education, working 3 to 11, and believe it or not, having a date at 11:30 or 12 o'clock at night for an hour or so was the standard way kids lived in the Monongahela Valley. And it was just a different way to raise kids.
Did you graduate from high school?
In December, or in 1944, in June. Mm-hmm. And the war years were still going on. And I had signed up for the Navy Air Corps and had been accepted into it. And the war was beginning to wind down as a result, where they had been flooding these Navy programs or Army programs with officers, training programs, and for the flight schools and everything. They could see that the war was winding down, and as a result, they began to cut back on these programs. So because I had been accepted by the Navy, they then said that they weren't going to be taking this in the flight schools, and they gave us a whole bunch of different opportunities. And one of the opportunities that they offered was a, to me at that time, was a relatively new education, in which there are 5 federal academies. The original one, of course, was the, to best of my knowledge, was the Coast Guard Academy, and then the Navy Academy and the military, West Point. They had also then formed, in the war years, Kings Point, which was the Merchant Marine Academy. And later, after that, after the war, they formed the Air Force Academy. And anyhow, why under World War II, why the Merchant Marine Academy was run by the Navy. So since they closed down the air program that I'd been accepted in, like, they offered a chance to take, we could take the entrance examination into Kings Point, which I did do and did manage to pass. And you then had to get a congressional appointment to go to the academy, which I was able to get. And
how were you able to get that?
How did they get that?
Yeah.
Well, they listed your representative to the House of Representatives and your state senator, and you would have to write them a letter and give them notice that you had passed the examination, and it was entirely up to him to say whether or not he would recommend you to go to the academy. And at that time, because the school was relatively new, and the representatives that were in Pennsylvania from the Philadelphia area were sort of loaded up with candidates, but from the western Pennsylvania area, why, there were very few people even knew about it. So our western Pennsylvania representative didn't have very many people applying for it. So through him, and then whatever he recommended, then the state senator would also then approve. So that's how I got the acceptance in the Kings Point.
And,
this was also in 44. I graduated in June of 44. and was accepted into the academy. They gave me notice of acceptance in August of 44, but I was not to report until the December class. And the first plebe class was starting then in the, not the first of the academy, but my plebe class would start in December. So just after Christmas, I think it was December 27th or 28th, I had to report to the academy. And during those days, my transportation was very difficult. Gasoline was rationed. So to be able to get from Donora into Pittsburgh, well, the only way we could get there was by train. The buses were limited as to how many they could run. Dad didn't have the gasoline available to take me to Pittsburgh, so we went down and got on the local train into Pittsburgh. He went in with me to there and to Pittsburgh. And because everybody was in that same situation, we had to ride in the baggage compartment of the train. And it was stuffed with all kinds of people. And we stood up there or sat on my suitcase. And then when I got to Pittsburgh, my mom and dad had prearranged for me to have a sleeping coach, which was quite a unique thing for a young guy, never really been on a train, to find his way into a sleeping compartment. But I did, and Dad left me, of course, in Pittsburgh and got to New York City. When I got off the train, there was a telephone number that you were supposed to call, and they would then tell you where to go from there. I had enough money to make the taxi cab ride down to the spot that we were going. And then once you reached that point, you went through all the paperwork and shuffled off to Kings Point Academy, which was out in Long Island. Kings Point, Long Island.
That's the first time you ever left Donora, let alone the Pittsburgh
area. Oh, yeah. This was a traumatic experience. Just out of high school, had been working in the mills and going off into a big, wide, wonderful world out there.
But
it wasn't a matter of going to school. At that time, you were going into the service, and it was run by the Navy, and because I was not eligible to go then to the Navy Air Corps program, and this was an alternative, I went there, and at the academy, you were a cadet midshipman. We were under the USN program when I initially went in, and then they changed it to the USNR, U.S. Navy Reserve program. I went in as a plebe. The program at that time was on an accelerated wartime program, and you could accept an appointment or a cadet's assignment as either a deck cadet or an engine cadet. And I chose the engine only because I figured that would be more of an education for me, something I could do later on in life rather than just be on the running a ship. And, so anyhow, I was assigned an engineering cadet's assignment, and that's what it was. And the situation was that you'd serve a plebe, you're in the war program, which is only 4 months at that time. Then, from there you would go 6 months to sea, that would be a total of 10. And then you had, 18 months altogether. So you would have been 8 more months back at the academy. And that was the so-called program that I would have graduated. But it didn't turn out that way. I ended up being swung as the war years diminished, and as the service finished up, I ended up with a 4-year whole training program. And that 4 years ended up being 4 solid years. It isn't like you had summer vacations or anything like that. So, it's quite an education.
Well, during that period, you remember, where were you when you found out that Roosevelt died?
When Roosevelt died, I was at the Academy, thinking of the time frame. That must have been March or April of 45, in that time frame anyhow. I remember that he died, they had it on the radio at the time. Very traumatic event going on. Everybody was quite shook up what that meant for the war years and how would they go on from there. Ultimately in 45, VE, Victory in Europe, was declared later in the year, and then VJ Day even later, I believe also in 45.
Well, I just back up a little bit. If you look, you talked about the Depression, but Pearl Harbor, it must have come as a tremendous shock to America, let alone steel mills of Pennsylvania, just the fact that somebody would attack the United States. Do you recall that much?
Yeah, very much so, because at that time, young kid, I was really interested in that type of thing. And I would listen to the radio, and I would follow the news as it was coming out. And you could almost see the programming of it. You could almost have an instinct. Here's what's going to happen next. And I would listen to the news, and I would hand hunt and peck on the typewriter there and type out little news bulletins about what was going on with the war. And you began to see that either the seeds were being planted, that this or that would occur by the news media or the governments, but you could tell that something was about to occur when the United States went into the war, about Britain being in the war when its time was there. You could tell that something was going to develop regarding Japan. You knew that ahead of time, but as to when and where, no, the magnitude of the strike on Pearl Harbor was very, very impressionable. Roosevelt did a good job in portraying the terribleness of that incident. And of course, why then, the United States was fully involved then, from that point forward. In the meantime, prior to that, the United States, the mills were belting out as much as they could, trying to help Russia and England with supplies and everything of that nature. While the United States was trying to build itself up to be able to cope with the war before they really got into it.
So we fast forward,
your
Merchant Marines Academy you graduated from there when?
December of 48, but my programming as a plebe, I was there for only 4 months as a plebe. Typically nowadays, you're in as a plebe for 1 year, you're in as a third classman for a year, that year is at sea. Then you go back to the academy for 2 years, and you're second or first class. Then at that time, first class is your last year. And when I was at the academy, I was fortunate enough after the sea duty that I was appointed a cadet officer. I was the 9th company commander. That was a big deal. Jim Gunter, my good friend, was my sub-company commander. We had some good times.
When did you go on really the seas,
when
you're in Argentina,
at
what point was this during that 4-year period
in
the Merchant Marine?
No, during, with the Merchant Marine time, and after the first 4 months, I was assigned, as is typical for those cadets, they would take one engineering cadet and one deck cadet was assigned to ships, no more than that. And you could be assigned to any kind of ship, a Navy ship or a cargo ship or whatever. My first ship that I was assigned to was the U.S. Lightning, which was the SS Lightning, I should say. The SS Lightning, which was a cargo ship carrying refrigerated cargo. And my assignment on it was to be the engineering cadet. And that was a diesel powered engine. Huge, absolutely huge. The cylinders were five stories high, and some doctrine opposed piston kind of thing. It was really a fascinating thing. But anyhow, as a cadet, I was assigned to the Lightning, went on board, tried to find my way around. Everybody was very friendly, and it came time to sail, and the pecking order, you have a captain and all of his mates, but you have then the chief engineer on board, then the first engineer, who's like the executive officer, and you have a second, third, and fourth engineer. Second, third, and fourth engineer covered the shifts, there's three shifts, if you will. But the fourth engineer, he missed the ship. And came time to throw off the lines, and because I was supposedly an engineering student, I was then assigned to move as a position to the fourth engineer, which, even though they call him the fourth, the rating is a third licensed engineer's position. But I was gaining engineering knowledge right from the word go. Terribly frightened. Awesome responsibility, but this huge thing pulled out with all these engines running, me wondering what they were all doing.
You were on the sea for how long did it take?
Well, typically the original programs were only to have been for 6 months at sea, but I spent a full 18 months at sea, and during that time I had been back and forth across the Atlantic very frequently. And sailing to France. My first trip was to France and England. And we went to Le Havre, France. And when we got there, of course, you could see all the war damages. We used to go in convoy. We were always in convoy in the early stages because the war at that point was still underway. And we would go out with maybe 30 to 50 ships, and then with destroyer escorts all around. And you'd take off with this big fleet of ships and some destroyers trying to protect you out there. This whole gang of ships, not in one big single line, but in rows, but staggered, so that if somebody shot a torpedo, you'd have a chance of at least missing something. But there were ships sunk en route. And,
did he alert you you're under attack, or is it just one of those things that...
Oh yeah, you knew. Mm-hmm. You knew, but they didn't come on by vocally telling you over the radio. They would either flash signals or raise certain pennant flags of certain colors, which would tell you that you're under an attack. But anyhow, that would have been from I was out then in May, around May 1st of 45, and the VJ day, as I recall, in August or September there. And my tours were to England, France, Belgium, and then into Italy, Egypt, Greece, and then over into the Pacific, went down through the Panama Canal, and out into the Pacific and went to Okinawa in the Philippines, a whole series of islands out there. And in the Philippines, because the ship I was assigned to was a refrigerated cargo ship, and we had all fresh meat. And typically you would pull at the port and unload the meat into the military warehouses. Well, I think it was about a day and a half before we got into Tacloban Lady in the Philippines by the warehouse front. So as a result, we ended up spending, I think it was about 2.5 months in Tacloban Lady and anchored out while they had these amphibious ducks which would leave the shore, taxi themselves on out to the side of the ship and place their order for what they wanted. We'd unload that, load up these little ducks with meats, fresh fruits, and that would go ashore and feed. So the military had to eat their way through our ship before we were allowed to leave.
These were commercial ships, though, that were kind of leased out by the government?
Yeah, they were taken over by the government. And the whole purpose of King's Point is that since commercial ships can be anybody from any place in the world working on board the ships as a paid employee, the officers have to be licensed, either licensed, USA licensed, deck or engineering officer, meaning they have to have certain qualifications. But also, prior to King's Point time, there was no way of controlling what those ships could do on an immediate basis. So the idea was that all USA ships would have, as an absolute minimum, one engineering officer and one deck officer who was USNR at least on board, so that in the event of a war or emergency or anything, they would then radio the ship and the U.S. government could take control of the ship through those two officers. And even though they may be the very junior officer of all juniors, they would have to assume command, and the captains were responsible to report it. The system, of course, was the captain would still do the captain's duties, but the legal right to do all of this was embodied just in the fact that you had one engineering officer and one deck officer that the government could control.
You ended up in Argentina at some point, didn't you?
Yeah, after the war was over, and after the education at King's Point was over, well, of course, I was a licensed engineering officer, and came out in December of 48, was my graduation. And at that time, while the military certainly didn't want anybody, they were trying to dump people out, so you had to go and get a job, and my only training was this maritime engineering. So I looked around for a job, and I went with Moore McCormick Steamship Line, and Moore McCormick assigned me to some cargo ships, the Moore Mac Gulf, the Moore Mac Reed, the Moore Mac Wren. The reason would be that you'd end up on all these different ships was you'd make a voyage and you had to sign a contract to go out to that place wherever it was. And then whenever they got back, at the time you were back and the cargo was removed at that time, you were then, quote, discharged from your agreement. And then you could either re-sign on board, or if they were going to a place you didn't want to go to, you could leave and get another job. And anyhow, I stayed with the Moore McCormick Line. They would then transfer me around to the different cargo ships. Well, because I became a reasonably proficient engineer in their minds, having been on turbines and diesels and everything else, they had the luxury liners, more McCormick did, and the three luxury liners that they had were the Brazil, the Uruguay, and the Argentina. And I was assigned then to go on the Brazil. And the Brazil made 42-day round trips from New York to Trinidad was the stop. And in Trinidad, you would always, if you were southbound, you would always meet them northbound of those three ships, was the way the schedules worked out. And the northbound ship always had a party on board it for the passengers. It was a big time party pack. So in any event, the 42-day trips consisted of New York, Trinidad, then frequently we would stop at Bolama, which is the mouth of the Amazon River, then on down to Rio de Janeiro, and Santos, Brazil, and then Montevideo, and Buenos Aires, and then you bump back up again to Uruguay, Montevideo, and either Rio or Santos. And you might hit Recife, some hidden crazy little port along the way on the coast of Brazil, and then on back to the States.
You were there during the time, Juan Perón, Eva Perón?
Yeah. Eva Perón was running the country down there. It was really fascinating because, first of all, at that time, the Argentinians simply did not like the Americans for any number of reasons. And Argentina also housed a lot of the German officers, the German military, went down there after the war. But in any event, Evita was the big thing there. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that she used to do was to call these big meetings in up at the palace. And she would stand on top. She would stand on top of the palace balcony up there, and she would come out and speak to the people. And she would always end up by somewhat telling them that she had been a poor girl and she had done very well. And she and her husband were going to do right by them. And she was always very benevolent in that, you see, I have this beautiful flowered dress on or evening gown type of thing. And she would show them from this balcony. And then these trucks would pull in the periphery of these crowds. And then they would open the doors to the trailer trucks and they would start tossing out all these dresses, which were very similar to her dress, and that was her gift to the people. But the truth of the matter is that she and her husband really ran, you might say drug market, but I don't mean marijuana or opium or anything like that, although it might have been at all. They ran the legitimate aspirin, pills, you know, so-called sulfa drug. They controlled all the medicinal drugs in for the country. As a result, they had pretty tight control over things, and they marked up through their distribution system. That's how they made a lot of their money, by controlling the medicinal drugs. I'm not talking about the drugs of opium or anything of that nature.
Did you ever see her?
Oh, sure. Yeah, absolutely. And as a matter of fact, I got into real trouble unknowingly. The women's clubs in Argentina, some of them were very violently against Evita. I don't say violently, I don't mean that. They were very much opposed in writing. And I remember going when I was in Buenos Aires to a department store. And when I went into the department store, what I was doing was going looking for souvenirs for my mom and dad. And as a matter of fact, I got them little teaspoons type of thing. But anyhow, what, to do that, I had to go up three or four flights in the department store. And when I went into the store, though, at the entranceway, there was this whole gang of ladies which were passing out pamphlets. And, of course, it was in Spanish. And I didn't speak Spanish. I took it, had a picture of Evita on it, and in Spanish words. Put it in my pocket. Went on up to the third floor. When I came back down, the store, which had been, it was like Kaufman's or Gimbel's, the equivalent of Buenos Aires. When I came down, there was nobody there, hardly, in the downstairs levels. So I proceeded to start out the door. First thing I know, the police were there. And they searched you down, and I had this pamphlet on me. And apparently the pamphlet was all about Evita and the wrong things that she was doing, and her trying to present it in a different kind of light. So they were somewhat objective to it. But anyhow, everybody who was there who had the pamphlet all had to go off to the police station. And of course, I had my passport with me. It was a Siemens, my passport. And I was then able, the worst thing in the world you could have happen to you is be turned over or asked for. They always told us that on the ship. If anything ever happens, don't ask for the U.S. Embassy. Always ask for the British Embassy. So I asked for the British Embassy. They then were able to do whatever they did in their magical ways. Myself and there was another young engineer that had also had the same experience. They got us both out and we went back to the ship. But it was strange. They really detested the Argentinians at that time. They really detested the USA nation.
What led you to ultimately leave the McCormick
Club? There's an old adage in this seafaring trade business is that if you stay at it too long, it gets ingrained in your blood, and that there was a nominal two-year time that was decreed, I guess, as being the time if you spent more than 2 years at it, you were in for your lifetime. And if you were able to get out within the 2 years, well, then you could have a short job and have a normal married life at home. And I, of course, wanted to have that, so without knowing anybody I was going to get married to. But I wanted to do that, I decided to leave and go get a shore-based job. And I did. I left and went worked for Copper's Company and started as a cadet with them. But that sea life on the luxury liners, as an engineering officer on there, that was fantastic living.
Oh, is that when you had the pet monkey?
No, I had the pet monkey when I was on the cargo ships.
And did you really shoot that alligator, or did you buy that in a store?
What, the alligator? No, we got that in Belém. That was on the Amazon River. Yeah. I didn't shoot it. I got it with a little small, you know. I got it with a little sheath knife, about a 6 or 8 inch long sheath knife. And I did it more as a dare, and then I felt so horrible about it afterwards. Well, to go in where there were little alligators, it takes a lot of courage, and that was, at that time, like, yeah, they caught it, and I caught it and handled it, and you were supposed to have it taken, and you were to kill it, and then have it stuffed. You paid the people to stuff it for you. That was their whole business and occupation at that time.
What about this monkey?
Oh, on the cargo ships where you could have any kind of pet you wanted. I had several pets, really, with the on board the cargo ship. I had a monkey, and I also had at one time a cat-like, which Ocelot. And quite frankly, I wish later on I never would have had them, only because they were so much of a problem trying to maintain and keeping your stateroom, things of that nature. By the way, even then, going to sea as an engineer, you had your private stateroom, and you had the purser's crew would come around, and the cabin attendant would clean up your rooms and just everything. So it was a great deal. And then when you went to the luxury liners, it was even a better deal. And back on these animals, though, for a period of time, I had this monkey, and it would stay outside my room in its own caged area, which we had built. But one day it did escape, and because I was an engineering crew, my room was close to the top of the engine room area. I was on the outside, ocean side, but the it escaped and it went to the top of the engine room. And it was jumping around from pieces of equipment to pieces of equipment. They finally chased it out of the engine room and got up on deck. And then it was over at the side of the ship up on deck, on the first deck level there. And we were passing a whole, it was in the Pacific area that we were. Just as a matter of fact, it was just outside of outside of Guam, and it's with a lot of flying fish. And I never saw so many flying fish in all my life going on at that time. But anyhow, the monkey, I think, stopped to look, and he stopped to look, and everybody was trying to catch him, and he sort of got pushed right into the water he went, and that was the end of the dear old monkey.
Did it have a name?
Yeah, we called him Chip.
Chip?
Chip, yeah. Little Chip. And Brian was just cute. It was nice. Didn't cause any real problem except escaping into the engine room. That was a problem. Chief engineer went right through the roof.
Well, when you were on those luxury liners, so you got to live sort of the life of a dandy at that point. I remember seeing the elegant menus. I remember
The menus were superb. Very decorative menus, all kinds of exotic foods. Oh yeah, absolutely. And of course, the food was superb.
You eat. Yeah.
Yeah. The food was great because we always would pick up fresh meat out of Argentina, and we would pick up fresh lamb, things like that, out of and hams, out of Uruguay. And regarding the butterfly, so you would eat the very best of food, and cooked by the best of cooks, because the luxury liners would pay to have the most capable chefs they could get. And then as far as these butterflies she's talking about, when you would go into Brazil, of course the country just up along the Amazon had thousands of different varieties of butterflies. And one of the trades that was going on up there was they would make little trays with glass tops and table tops. And what they would do is they would make them out of these Brazilian pine, which had if you put a light underneath these tables, a brilliant red glow from the knots that were in it. But the tabletop was also wood, and then it had glass on the top. But under there were designs of all butterflies, were all laid out. It's absolutely gorgeous.
That's when you lived the life of the dandy, you were in
dance
with the ladies on the ship.
Well, what it was I had the greatest deal finally, where I was doing what was called the second engineer, and the second engineer's watches were 4 to 8. 4 o'clock in the morning to 8 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock at night to 8 o'clock at night. And because the passengers' meals would then commence being served like 6:30 in the morning or 7 o'clock in the morning, as well as in the evening hours. And because it was tradition that every table had to have an engineering or a deck officer, junior or senior, at the table. And so therefore, I would get relieved, so I'd spend very little time on the watch duty, by a junior engineer. And I'd have a chance to come up to my cabin, wash up, put my white uniform on, go down to the evening meal or the morning breakfast, and sit there and talk to the passengers and answer questions. That was a pretty nice duty. Then, of course, going to Brazil and Uruguay, the casinos and the roulette and the blackjack and all that, that was big time living. No. It's all part of that fascination of why you don't quit. You keep right on going past your 2 year time.
They used to have a slogan you used to wake us up with when we were little kids.
Oh, yeah, let's see. Rise and shine with Moore McCormick line. You would always be called for your watch at 4 o'clock in the morning, or before 4 o'clock. And the steward would come around and knock on your door, and then he'd open the door, shout in there, rise and shine with Moore McCormick line. That would be your wake-up call. So I used to say that to the kids.
Did it work?
Yeah, reasonably, once in a while.
Okay, then you came back to state. Are you getting tired at all?
No, I'm fine.
Okay, so, well, we can just snap this off and run.
It would be December of 50, and well, sandwiched in there, I made a trip to the American export line off to Italy and Greece.
Oh, you got the blue glasses, that blue
combo? From Venice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But then, let's see. I came home, I got a job with Coppers. When did I get the job with Coppers? In 1951, towards the end of 51.
Why Coppers, of all places?
Oh, why Coppers? Well, I was trying to get a job in the Beaver Valley, not the Beaver Valley, in the area, Denard, Pittsburgh, or where have you. So I would read the Sunday paper, see who was advertising for a job, and there was this company called Coppers, but I didn't know a whole lot about Coppers at that time. But they were advertising for engineers and what have you. So knowing that I was at home at that time without a job, that I needed to get a job fairly soon. So I went in for an interview, and when I got there, well, they said, yes, we would like to talk to you, but we want you to come down to the Monaca plant, Monaca, Pennsylvania plant, and talk to the personnel manager there. So with that, then, I went down to see the personnel manager, and he interviewed me for my background and experience. And on the spot, then, he offered me a job as a cadet engineer. And a cadet in a chemical operation, or any business operation, that's as low as you can go and still be human on the salary totem poles. So because it was so low, they then decided that, well, they would give me a wage hour rate of pay, meaning an hourly rate. So I started as a cadet, and when the job of a cadet was, I would then get assigned to the maintenance department of the Cabuda plant, which was a chemical plant.
And located where?
Outside of Monaca, Pennsylvania, on the Ohio River. And that plant was a fairly large plant. It had about 4,500 employees. And it had quite a number of operations in it. It had an oil cracking plant where you take crude oil and you would refine it, take all the tar and the sludge out of it, and then you would have refined oil, which you'd use in the process later on. And it had a butadiene plant, four of the world's largest butadiene plants. And butadiene is a chemical liquid. When mixed with styrene monomer, which they also made, the same plant, formed synthetic rubber. And the whole reason the plant was there in the first place was because Copper's company had been assigned during the war years to build and manage a rubber reserve plant to make synthetic rubber for the government. So the plant was pretty large, and it had these oil cracking plant, it had four butadiene units, and it also had a styrene plant. Well, we used to bring in light oil by rail cars, as well as from the oil cracking plant. And the light oil would come typically from Copper's coke plants, where they make coke. And the light oil we then would convert to benzene, toluene, and xylene. And we brought in barges of grain alcohol and converted it into ethylene, and then took the benzene from the light oil plant, combined it with the ethylene. That then made ethyl benzene, and from the ethyl benzene, then you refined it more, and that became styrene monomer, which was a liquid. And you would hit that liquid with catalysts, and the styrene monomer would then turn into polystyrene, which was a plastic. So we also had a huge boiler plant at the facility, and if it wasn't used to supply just the electric and steam and power for the plant, it would also sell power to the public utilities. We also had a phthalic and hydrogen plant there, which all the stuff was paint formulations. And then we also made the styrene-butadiene latices, which were, again, paint formulations. Well, I started there as a cadet. My cadet assignment then led me into being maintenance supervisor in butadiene unit number 4. I was responsible for the maintenance of all these various distillation columns and reactors, and et cetera. A lot of automation. Yeah. And because of the engineering training that I had in the background, even though it was a whole new field, not the ocean-going marine field, because they had a lot of similar equipment, compressors and boilers, so I was able to pick all that up pretty quickly. As a result, then, I was then made maintenance supervisor for all 4 butadiene units. And then because I did that pretty well, and because the company's program was to keep moving the people they thought they could train to different sections, then they put me in the powerhouse so I learned all about it. And then from there to all of the benzene, toluene, xylene, all the styrene, monomer, all the maintenance of those, not the operations of them, not for the operating department, but for the mechanical maintenance, which you really had to know how they all worked and why they worked that way. So I did all of that, and then they decided to put me over into the phthalic and hydride operations to learn all of that. That was a real bear, though. That was, that place used to explode just by looking at it, blow up. But in any event, I advanced then from an area maintenance supervisor to assistant superintendent of maintenance, and then the next thing that happened was Coppers then formed a management training program. Coppers had 8 different divisions, engineering construction division, coke, chemical, wood preserving, a bunch of different mechanical, metal products division, chemical division that I was in. And they then embarked upon a program where they would take 2 people per year, once every 6 months, from all different divisions, lock, stock, and barrel. They would appoint 1 management trainee. And they would then assign that management trainee to all aspects of Coppers Company. Well, I was fortunate enough to get appointed to that. And for the 2-year period of time then, I was put into sales and research and development. Development was different from research. And to marketing, which is different from sales. And production, legal departments, accounting departments, things that you spent so much time in each area. But assigned specific work in those areas. And if you were sales on the road, you had certain supervisors, the key supervisors, to go and know certain accounts and what have you. So it was quite a tremendous, tremendous training program. So after all was all said and done with that training program, then I came back into the Kubota plant as a superintendent then, primarily the chemical sections. And then I was sent to Berkeley Heights, New Jersey, to be involved as engineering, as the plant engineer for the Berkeley Heights plant, which was a polystyrene plant that produced polystyrene and compounded things of that nature. And then was reassigned from there back as assistant superintendent of the Kubota plant, or as assistant plant manager of the Kubota plant. Then I was sent off for a brief period of time to Germany to help a team that was going to participate in buying the Ziegler low pressure, high density polyethylene process from the Germans. And it was just off of a laboratory bench. Anyhow, after that license was acquired by Coppers, then they built a plant in Port Reading, New Jersey. And at that time, I was managing the Kubota plant, which is a 4,500-man plant, big operation for a young guy. And they then got into a lot of political and social problems at the new Port Reading, New Jersey plant. Matter of fact, the citizens were all up in arms and wanted the plant closed, et cetera. And the plant manager that they had there at that time was having problems. So I was sandwiched in then to become the plant manager of the New Jersey plant. Went down, met with the press, and met with all the citizens and the little old ladies and the government people and the mayors and what have you, to talk about the plant and show them the plant. And then it began to quiet down. We were able to do things that helped. But then I'm jumping way ahead of myself here, because But I was at the Kubota plant as a young engineer. I started with coppers in 51. In 1952, I met Maybell, Maybell Freshcorn.
Now, prior to that, you were living at home?
Well, I had left Denora, where that was my home, but I was renting space from a Mrs. Patton in Beaver. And I had a little Nash convertible that time, and I would drive back and forth. I sort of got ahead of myself there.
Nash Rambler.
Had my Nash Rambler, and in 51 I was working for coppers, living in the Beaver Valley, in Beaver, Pennsylvania, and staying with Mrs. Patton, and driving back and forth to work with Craig Galt, who was superintendent of maintenance, for whom I was working initially. And at the butadiene units, which I ended up being responsible for, they had laboratories. And those laboratories were independent buildings. And in the laboratories were various female and male people doing all the analysis. And there was this Maybell Freshcorn, who looked pretty good to me, who worked in there. And although I didn't really meet her or talk to her or anything of that nature, but ultimately I was invited by the laboratory superintendent to the laboratory picnic, which was to be held on a whatever September day in the local park. And I think it was on a Sunday afternoon. So I came back from Denora to come back to the valley early. Went to this park, and after I parked my car and was walking up the hill, this ball came sailing at me. And the sailing ball was followed by words of, "Hey, catch." And here Maybell is throwing this softball as hard as she could right at me. And I, really, to defend myself, I just put my hand up and made a fortunate catch. But anyhow, that's how I finally met Maybell. And that was in about September of 51. All right. September of 51, because in December we got engaged. And I was married in 52 in June. Right, so that had to be September 51. Anyhow, when I got married in...
just can't gloss over that easily. You saw her,
Well, that was a picnic event that was going on at that time. We talked then, and she had some things to do, and I had some people that I was supposed to meet with that evening. And so anyhow, we agreed we would make contact later on, and she was plenty good looking. I was really interested. So as a result, we had a few dates after that. Then I wanted to show her to mom and dad. So I got them to want to go to the horse races, mother and dad, in, I believe it was Wheeling, or Washington, Pennsylvania, somewhere in there. And so I asked Maybell if she wanted to come down to go with my mom and dad to the horse races, which we did. And then we kept dating fairly steadily after that, and ultimately decided to get married. Got engaged in December. Oh yeah, I went about it very, very formally, trying to be a nice guy, and he was very nice about the whole thing. And they said yes.
Dude, I probably dated other women prior to Mabel. So did your mom and dad have any initial reactions to Mabel?
They liked her very much. Especially like some of the women that I'd been dating. I think that they were quite relieved. And anyhow, my mother was very, very quick to like Mabel. And I think they became very good past friends after that. After all the rest of the time, as long as she lived, Mabel got along real well with my mom and dad.
Did your dad take an active interest in who you were dating, or just sort of like...
Oh, no, you could date who you wanted, but he liked Mabel. He really did. And as a result, we ultimately, during their lifetime, had built a summer place at Conneaut Lake, and we were living in New Jersey, and they would come out and visit us there. And while we were having children, being born, they would come to be around whenever the children were being born. And then anytime we wanted to go away on any trips or anything, they would come and take care of the babysitter. He died when he was 65, and so my dad and I were 30 years apart. So he died when I was 35.
And he worked at American Steel?
American Steel Works, and he was the personnel manager. It was a nice job.
You worked there
until
retirement?
Mm-hmm. Well, Dad had he early retired. He early retired because he had a bad heart. And he'd had if they're in my mother and dad's younger married life, they had purchased a home, and when they had some repairs that were required for the home, which were with the sewer line repairs, he then contracted, trying to think whether it would have been typhoid or diphtheria, something really serious like that. As a result, what happened was apparently scar tissue built up on the nerves that attach to the heart. And as is typical, from that the scar tissue finally breaks the nerve wires. And my dad had what they then called Stokes-Adams syndrome, which meant that his heart would beat a permanent 32 beats rather than a typical person who was at rest for 70, 80. And as they would need to accelerate and run or something, a normal heart picks up in pulse beats, heartbeats. But his was limited to the 32 no matter what he did. And as a result, that was a pretty good size handicap, not being able to do things where your heart would be required to accelerate. So he lived with that ailment for about 8 or 9 years. And he had to go in finally because he was experiencing heart failure. For at that time, one of the first heart pacemakers. And the heart operation for installing the pacemaker was a success. The only problem was they couldn't get him up out of the anesthesia. Mm-hmm. And as a result, he never did come out of it. But he lived on for 4 or 5 days. But in a sleeping condition. Anyhow, he He died from that. My mother died from a stroke. They're also at age 65.
She lived a little bit longer than she died.
No, she, he died in April, and she died in August of the same year.
Was she very scared or distraught after your dad died? Because it
was real, I think traumatic. It bothered her, traumatic. The two of them were very, very close. And, I think that had a lot to do with it. My mother died in church. She had, Maybelle had taught my mother how to drive, and she had her car. And Aunt Stell, my dad's sister, which was a very good friend of my dad and my mother, had come down to visit, and they decided to go to church this Sunday. And they had, mother drove to the church, and they got there in church, and the church service had just started. She just collapsed over and had a cerebral hemorrhage.
You had to eulogize your dad. What would you say?
He was really a great guy. He did the best he could to really provide for the family. Of course, he lived through a very, very tough time for being able to provide anything with the depression and all of that. And even when he did provide, it wasn't for his own family, but because my granddad Reynolds then ultimately had had a stroke and wasn't able to do his carpenter work, so he then also had to provide for Nanny and Pop. And then on top of it was Uncle Charles, my mother's brother, wasn't able to get much of work. And as a matter of fact, if he ever had any money, he would spend it on punch boards. And I don't know if you're familiar with a punch board, but he would spend quite a bit of money on it. And as a result, my dad also had to share whatever earnings he had to try to help feed that group too. So it was a very tough time. They made the best they possibly could out of what they had, and they did well.
Did you eulogize your mother?
Oh, a superb person who was very knowledgeable, very tactful, very friendly, could encourage anybody into anything that they wanted to do. A very diplomatic person. Really great. Good mom and dad.
Now we meet Maybelle. Yep. And it's in December of 1951 you get engaged. You've done the proper thing. You've asked for Maybelle's hand when Mike has said yes. And your mom and dad think she's okay. So,
they thought she was great.
And now we look forward to the wedding day.
Well, we picked a wedding date, and the date that was picked was June 21st, and to me, that sounded like just a great date, and I never realized the humor of that until much later on, but the secret to June 21st is that it's the longest day and the shortest night of the year, so therefore all the boys kid me that Maybelle's a whole lot smarter than I was. But anyhow, we really had a great married life together. Raised three kids. We think a lot of each other.
Okay, during that, you got married where?
Got married in the Baptist Church in Rochester, which was Maybelle's church that she'd grown up in. And it was June in the afternoon, June 21st. I believe at 4:30 in the afternoon, and
who were the wedding attendants?
good question. I think that, well, let's see. Craig Galt was there as an usher. Irv Harrison, he was sort of the head usher for Craig Galt. Irv Harrison was my best man. And Maybelle had her girlfriend. I can't think of her name just offhand. I should, but I can't. It was her maid of honor. Probably was Jerry. What am I thinking about? Must have been Jerry. And a group of bridesmaids. And Earl Goh was in my wedding party. In any event,
your best man was?
My Irv Harrison. And of course, the duties of a best man are to, you know, to help take care of the groom and to make sure everything's all right, to provide him for his transportation. But a real funny thing happened there. The wedding was in the Baptist church, and a wedding reception was held downstairs in the Baptist church. And cake and drinks and soft drinks and that type of thing. And a few speeches and talks. And after that was over, well, then everyone was invited up to Mary Mike Freshcorn's place for the booze party of the wedding. And the photographer had asked Maybelle and I to stay for a few moments so that pictures could be taken. And he took pictures at the, up around the altar and us together at different spots. And after the pictures were all set and done, well, he folded up all of his stuff and left from the top level of the church. And Maybelle wanted to go downstairs to see if anything left had to be cleaned up or done downstairs or if anybody was there. We went down and absolutely nobody was there. And we left to go out, and Irv, who was going to provide us transportation, wasn't around at all. So the only way we got from the church in our her wedding gown and me in my tuxedo was that a Pepsi truck came along, and I hitched a ride with him, and he was very pleased and honored to be able to take the bride and groom up to Mary and Mike Freshcorn's place, which was about the, well, geez, it had to be 15 blocks or more away, 15, 20 blocks. So it was quite a ride up there. So we pile out of the Pepsi truck and thank the guy very much and went into the reception. Then after that reception was over, well, then we went off to the Greater Pittsburgh Airport, stayed there that night at the airport hotel right inside the main terminal there, and left the next day for Bermuda for a honeymoon. Again, Irv had been arranged to pick us up when we get home, and he forgot all about it. As a result, Maybelle and I were stranded at the airport when we came back in, and we'd managed to blow all of our money on our honeymoon. And as a result, I was able to hitchhike a ride back to the Beaver Valley from the Greater Pittsburgh Airport with Michael Baker Engineering Company, who was there. They were glad to accommodate us, very pleased to do it. But it was really a hairy time. Irv's all right. He's a good guy.
Now, you were living where? You were married. What was home?
Well, we lived briefly with the Mike and Mary Freshcorn. However, before we got married, after we were engaged in December, I took some money I had saved up and borrowed some money from my dad and was able to go out and buy a lot out on Tuscarora's Road, which is back in Beaver, Pennsylvania. And Maybelle and I started building a house together before we got married. So for the 6 months' time between December and June, we were working on a home. We went out and we picked up an Admiral home, which was a prefabricated home. Ours was all brick and stone. And it was a Cape Cod style. We had the foundation put in, and the shell went up, and then all the brick went up. And then on the inside, like Maybell and I did the plumbing and the wiring and putting the insulation in and the rock lath and the taping and the painting. It was quite a job, quite a job.
Then you got married and...
Went off to Bermuda, and we used her savings to pay for the honeymoon end of it. And because I'd put everything that I'd had into the house as it progressed along.
She was a good investment.
Oh, absolutely. So we came home from there, and the water line to supply water to the whole Tuscarora system up there, we were counting on city water. And we hadn't dug any wells or anything. And the town was busy laying this pipeline, which they did, built a complete pump station, and pipeline and everything else. And there was this final spool piece, just maybe about that wide, probably about a 10-inch diameter, 12-inch diameter pipe, but just needed that spool piece made. And they had spent a month fooling around, trying to get that piece made. So I had gone to Coppers and I talked to them, and I was able to pay for the Coppers people to make that spool piece for me, so I could take it out to the township engineer, be able to give it to him so they could install it so we could get water to the whole neighborhood out there. It was an interesting time. But that's the reason we couldn't move in right away. There just wasn't any water.
Who helped you in building the house? Did Mike?
Oh, Mike Freshcorn was a tremendous help on building. He was very good. The only thing is, Maybell and I putting the plumbing in, we made a lot of mistakes. The solder leaked at the joints. We hadn't done that very well. So we gained a tremendous experience on how you really solder pipe to make it stick. That was good. But we did very well. Then we added the second story, the dormers and all, to it, and a breezeway, and two-car garage, and lived there, and Cindy was born there. And well, in the hospital, so he was born at the Rochester Hospital. But we did very well there.
We're going to have our wedding vows reconfirmed today here. And probably a good time to take a break, and then we're going to talk about the kids.
The wedding vows are going to be reconfirmed on the American Queen. Okay.
Spending your most precious commodity, and that is your time with us here on board our beautiful steamboat. I'm happy that you accepted our invitation to renew your wedding vows today and welcome you to this joyous occasion. We're delighted to have this unique opportunity to be able to have a wedding vow renewal ceremony on board the vessel while cruising the beautiful Ohio River. I've got three short selections that we'd like to share with you. They're appropriate to this ceremony. The first one comes from the pen of William Shakespeare. It's Love's Content. When in disgrace with fortune and men's eyes, I all alone be weak, my outcast state, and trouble death heaven with my fruitless cries, and look upon myself and curse my fate, wishing me like to one more rich in hope, featured like him with friends possessed. Desiring this man's art and that man's scope, with what I most enjoy, contented least. Yet in these thoughts myself almost despising, happily I think on thee. And then my state, like to the lark at break of day arising, from sullen earth sings hymns at heaven's gate. For thy sweet love remembered such wealth brings, but then I scorn to change my state with kings. Good wedding. O love, whose patient pilgrim feet life's longest path have trod, whose ministry hath symboled sweet the dearer love of God, the sacred myrtle rears again thine altar as of old, and what was green with summer then is mellowed now to gold. Not now as then the future's face is flushed with fancy's light, but memory with a milder grace shall rule the feast tonight. Blessed was the sun of joy that shone, nor less the blinding shower. The bud of 50 years agone is love's perfected flower. Final reading is entitled To His Wife, and by the 18th century English author and clergyman Samuel Bishop. Thee, Mary, with this ring I wed. So 14 years ago I said, behold, another ring. For what? To wed thee o'er again. Why not? With that first ring I married youth, grace, beauty, innocence, and truth, tastes long admired, sense long revered, and all my model then appeared. If she by merit since disclosed proved twice the woman I supposed, I plead the double merit now to justify a double vow. Here then today, with faith as sure, with ardor as intense as pure, as when amidst the rites divine I took thy troth and plighted mine. To thee, sweet girl, my second ring, a token and a pledge I bring. With this I wed, till death us part, thy riper virtues to my heart. Those virtues which before untried the wife has added to the bride. Those virtues whose progressive claim enduring wedlock's very name. My soul of joys, my song approves for conscience' sake as well as love's. And why? They show me every hour honor's high thought, affection's power, discretion's deed, sound judgment's sentence, and teach me all things but repentance. These selections?
You're working at Copper's. You'd met and married Maybell. You'd come back from your honeymoon. Irv had forgotten you at various points during your wedding and your honeymoon. And now you're building a house at Tuscarora's Road. And that's where we ended up. This is, you had not had any children yet. So, yeah. You're working at we can talk a little bit about work. You know, you're still coppers at this time. The kids, you know.
Well, I think we talked about the Irv not getting us and riding home with Michael Baker.
Mm-hmm.
And that was quite an event for us. But after we finally got home, why, Maybell and I then earnestly went at work and finishing up on the house. And we had built this home, which was called an Admiral home. And we then proceeded to add the second level and the breezeway and a garage. Of course, during that process, why Cindy was born. And Cindy was born in, let's see, it must have been 53 in November, November 15th. And that was quite an event for us. And Cindy was a great daughter and a great pleasure. And when we were at home, why, of course, whenever I got home from work, why, Maybell would have Cindy all dressed up real fancy-like,
mm-hmm.
and we always had a great time. And As a matter of fact, over all the years, every time I would go to work, as she was growing up, she would always send one of her doll babies to work with me, or stuffed animals. And finally, while she had a bear called Big Ted, and Big Ted always had to go to work with me in the car, so that was quite a great time that we had. Cindy was born in 53. Jimmy was born after I had been transferred from the commuter plant to the New Jersey location, and he was born in Plainfield, New Jersey hospital. And let's see, that would have had to have been around 19, I probably shouldn't be giving dates at this time because I can't think that well, but probably around 56 or 57. And Jimmy was absolutely great. He was born in the middle of the night, about 1:30 in the morning. And after he was born, while we lived only for a fairly short period of time in Scotch Plains, New Jersey, I'd been managing the Berkeley Heights plant of Copper's Company at that time. And we had a great home there in New Jersey, in Scotch Plains. It really was a very pleasant place. But very shortly after Jimmy was born, I was then transferred back to the Cabuta plant. They had a number of problems there, and I had a chance then to really be elevated again to a higher position. And went back to the commuter plant, so even though I had shuttled by plane back and forth getting to New Jersey to run the New Jersey plant line, then I would spend time shuttling backwards again, so Maybelle and the kids were left on either end of the line. After we were back at the Beaver Valley again, we bought another home then. We sold the home in New Jersey. And we bought a home out farther out on that Tuscarawas Road. And Robert then was born when we were back in Pennsylvania. And he also was born at the Rochester Hospital. So that was my three children. They were all great, and we really had a great time with the kids through all their growth patterns. Let's see, after that time...
Still working for Coppers.
Still working for Coppers. And, well, let's see, shortly after Robert was born, and in about 1959, Coppers had built a brand new plant out in New Jersey again, a different plant than I'd been at in the first place, and a very much larger plant. And it was one of the very first polyethylene plants, and I was sent out to, as we mentioned previously, to run that operation. And we went there in 59, and let's see, I was with Coppers then, trying to think as to when I finally left them, must have been around 67. Our company now is 33 years old, so we are now a 96. 33 would be 66.
33. You're 33 years old now?
The company.
1963.
All right, well, I guess around 60. Yes, that's right, because in 63 we formed the company, Howard Industries.
What led you to leave Coppers and form Howard Industries?
Well, I was doing exceptionally well working for Coppers. had a reasonable job and a reasonable salary, and the living was good. But Coppers was then wanting to transfer me down to Texas, and I had been managing the second time out in New Jersey. I was then managing about three or four different plants, a coke plant and a plastics plant, and also was involved with a wood preserving plant, which was right behind the chemical plant that was there. And they decided they wanted to transfer me down to Texas location. And I'd always wanted to be in business for myself. And I thought that if I went down to Texas, then I'd get involved there and probably never have the courage or the opportunity to start a business for ourselves. So Mabel and I talked it over, and I decided to go in and meet with the head officers of Coppers Company at that time, because they had treated me pretty good. They had me previously on these specialized programs, and I had advanced in the company, and I wanted to be fair with them. And so anyhow, I went in and talked to them about the whole concept, and they said they understood and that they wished me well, and that if there was things we could do together, why, they'd enjoy doing that. So I did leave Coppers Company, and I already had a mortgage on the house, so we took a second mortgage on the house and took my paid-in pension, and we bought one single extrusion line to go into the plastic custom compounding business. And we had leased part of an old Mack Motors plant where they made the old Mack Motors trucks in Plainfield, New Jersey, was the start of it. So they had a fairly dingy building over there that we leased, and Maybell and I, why, we would take the kids and their kitty cars, and we would go over and we would paint the walls and the floors and everything before we got started on the inside of the building, so it would look clean and orderly. And it turned out to be a pretty nice little plant. And we bought this one single new extrusion piece of equipment, the best we could really get. And the reason we did that, we figured if we bought something brand spanking new, of course nothing would go wrong with it. Well, of course, the very first thing out of the Cracker Barrel was the machine failed, and it was part of the manufacturer's engineering, and that set us back a few months while we were getting started on it. But we had started business actually in September of, we formed the company in 63. We actually started in 64, pressing the button in Plainfield, New Jersey.
Why custom plastic?
Well, custom was sort of a safety valve on my part in going into business. The concept was that we would work for the major petrochemicals, the Dow, the DuPont, the Union Carbide, Exxon, people like that, which had chemical and plastics divisions. And at that time, we were only in the plastic things. They would get the customers, and they had a need. They were all huge, and we were ever so tiny. And they just simply had a need for somebody to make a truckload of a particular red polyethylene or green polystyrene or something of that nature. And it was a big pain in the butt for them to make those small quantity orders. So they were good for the money. You could count on them for paying you. And it was work that needed to be done. And it was a niche that we had a chance to fill. And of course, I had been in the petrochemical industry, and I sort of got to know a lot of people, because at that day and age, transfers between companies was a very common thing. And as a result, people that I had worked with in Coppers Company kept leaving and going to all these various other companies, so I had a chance to know a lot of people at different plant locations. So I followed, made contact with them, and found out if they had a need, and they always considered these specialty jobs a pain in the butt, and they would contract us to do it for so many cents per pound, and they would provide the formula, all the raw materials, all the additives, so we didn't have an expense that way. They paid freight in and freight out, and they paid for all the packaging supplies. So all we had to do was provide the machinery, the equipment, the people, the know-how, and do their job according to what they wanted to do. So that's why we worked for the majors, primarily because we believed they would pay their bills promptly. What we found out later on is some of them pay promptly and some of them stretch you out forever. But in any event, we got along fine. We got the company started. After we started with the one single line in Plainfield, very shortly thereafter, Coppers, with whom I'd worked, decided to merge with Sinclair Oil, forming a special division called Sinclair Coppers, and the chemical plastics division that I was in, which was one of eight Coppers company divisions, merged into the Sinclair Coppers. And then the plant in Berkeley Heights, New Jersey, that I had managed, which was the smaller of the several plants that were out in New Jersey, was shut down and put up for sale. I went in to see the people at Coppers and told them I didn't have the money at that time, but that we would like to buy that plant because it was a specialty compounding plant. All the machinery and equipment was there. So we were able to negotiate a deal to buy the lands and buildings. A strange thing happened at that time. Coppers, where I only wanted to buy the lands and the buildings of the operating area, they didn't want to be stuck, as they called it, with some surplus land, an additional 6 or 7 acres. At that time, I didn't want to be spending any more than I had to, but I was going to lose the deal unless I took the whole thing. So we cut the deal that we would buy the whole 12 acres of land, and of which 6 was operating lands and buildings, and 6 was just simply surplus prime land. And that turned out to be a real godsend, because we got the operation going in New Jersey. And that was fairly simple to do because everything was there. Mm-hmm. And our business began to pick up. And then the land behind us became more and more valuable as an industrial area. So we were able to sell off the 6 acres to various small industry buildings, all brand spanking new, and the area looked great. Of course, I didn't have any interest in the buildings that were put up. We just simply sold the land, and that gave us the opportunity to have some additional money. Mm-hmm. And with that money then, we expanded into Columbus, Ohio. We were expanding in two directions, this new plant in Berkeley Heights, New Jersey, and we decided to put a plant out in Columbus, Ohio, which we did. And then my attorney had made a trip to Mexico City for a vacation, and he liked his cocktail. So while he was staying at the International Hotel in Mexico City, he happened to run into a fellow from Union Carbide and just got to shooting the breeze. And the next thing I know, I received a call to come on down, that this guy wanted to talk to us about plastics, and where that particular contact didn't really develop into anything. What did develop was that we had a chance to get involved with other companies, Celanese, a USA corporation, which also had a division in Mexico, and Amoco had a division down there. We then had a chance to start doing custom compounding work for them in Mexico. And at that time, I had a chance to meet with Pepe Bandera and Manuel Moran, our attorney and general manager, great friends, a lot of good times together with those guys. So we also then opened up in Mexico City. And had some spectacular times, gave the children, my children, a real chance because we would spend a lot of time in the Yucatan Peninsula, pyramid hunting, and had some great times there.
You had a plant in Columbus. Whereabouts in Mexico?
A place called Tlalnepantla. Tlalnepantla. And that was really on the outskirts of Mexico City in a very industrialized area. The very first plant there was in a steel mill area, which was typical of all the industries. They fit into whatever industrial area was available. And we had a nice section of a plant there, and we worked for Amoco. We finally became their exclusive marketers for a period of time. It was only assigned for about a two-year period where we would also distribute and sell their brand spanking new product, which was polypropylene. So it worked well. We kept that business for quite a number of years, I believe about 16 years. And all during that time, we installed some new equipment. I think when we finally sold that plant, we had four production lines. When we sold the plant, it was just prior to the Mexican peso devaluation. We certainly had no idea that that was about to occur, and it turned out to be a fairly good thing for us. Manuel Moran, who was our plant manager down there, wanted to buy the operation, and we were interested in selling the operation because we wanted to expand into Houston, Texas. So we sold the plant to Manuel, who ran it for quite a number of years. And as a matter of fact, he ran it until he died, and then his children ran it for a period of time. And then they sold it to another organization in Mexico. It's still known as Himex, H-I-M-E-X, which originally stood for Howard Industries Mexico.
In Mexico, Himex, the plant you had started, sold to Manuel, and continues to be known as Himex, though Manuel has passed away. While in Mexico, one of the stories, at least I've heard, relating to the Howard family is regarding certain mining activities or claims, etc. Tell us about that.
My mother's maiden name was Reynolds, and her mother, Nell Reynolds, married John Reynolds. Her mother, Nell Reynolds, her maiden name, Nell Reynolds, was Osborne, A-U-S-B-U-R-N. And they lived, the Osborne family, heritage-wise, lived up on top of a very large hill, which is on Route 51 today, outside of Denora, across the river from Denora. And it was known as the Osborne Farm. And very historic in its way. Lafayette purportedly had stayed at the Osborne Farm. The Osborne family, which is my grandmother Reynolds' family, had a number of children. I'm really not quite sure. I think it was maybe seven Osborne children, one of which was an Uncle Cal, as we call him, Calvin Osborne. Cal Osborne was a very colorful type of person who had done a number of things. He, in his early life, was on the river boats with his brother, who I believe also became a captain of the river boats on the Ohio and Mississippi. But Uncle Cal wanted to do engineering, and he loved mining engineering. So as a result, he studied it, and at that day and age, any person who had the courage to go off to exotic